Table with your hosts, Heidi Hadquist and Luke Poland.
I can't get excited. I can't do, this is the problem. I want to be like, hello, kitties, and let's check traffic on the threes, but that's just not us.
We don't ever want to check traffic on the threes.
No, and I feel like I should.
Why?
Is that wrong? I mean, traffic's important.
Not to us.
Well, okay, fair.
I mean, if you're stuck in traffic, you can listen to this show longer, so we want people stuck in traffic.
That's true. That is true. Hello, kitties. Welcome to Rock and Roll Grad School, episode 3.
Why do you sound like you're at a funeral at episode 3?
See, this is my problem. I don't want to be like so over the top and morning zoo-ish, but then when I don't do that, I feel like I sound like I'm delivering someone's eulogy. This week in our bevy of introductory episodes to get you used to the show, today we have Doug, I'm going to mess up his last name.
Broad.
I was going to say Brood. Broad.
Only one O.
Thank you.
But we should maybe double check that, but there's only yeah. one O.
Yes.
Hey, I'm the one that called Ted Lange Lang for 30 years. It's fine.
I think most of us did, though.
True.
In your defense.
That's true.
Doug has written a lovely book called They Just Seem a Little Bit Weird.
Such a good book.
About, how would you describe it? I was going to say history of hard rock in the 70s, but it just really focuses on the four.
Right. It focuses on the four bands that he felt, and he's the former editor of Spin Magazine, so he has good cred to feel how he feels.
Yes.
That he felt these four bands
and ours.
Yes. These bands really shaped the future of music and shaped the time and the concert going experience. And although they were all very different, they all were influenced by one another in ways that I think even pretty big fans don't necessarily know. Mm-hmm. And so it takes a really cool look at these bands. And the bands are Kiss.
Cheap Trick.
Aerosmith. And the fourth band, which may come as a surprise to those who haven't read the book, is Starz.
And it came as a surprise to, I think, both of us.
Yes, it did.
In doing the reading, going, I think I even say in the interview, I thought I was well-versed in that era's music. And then come Starz out of nowhere where it's like, I don't know you people.
But that makes it really fun, too. And as a very big fan of all those bands, especially Cheap Trick, as our listeners have probably realized, you hear a lot about Kiss in general. There's a lot of books about them, fair amount about Aerosmith. You don't get to hear as much about Cheap Trick, but in this you do. Mm-hmm. And to learn about Starz was like going on the journey for the first time because I knew nothing about them.
Exactly. And it led me to their page on Spotify. And it's all really good stuff. And you listen to it being like, how did this not connect? Given knowing that these three bands were huge, how does this fourth one not ascend to those ranks?
Right. And I only was, you know, remotely inappropriate about my love of Tom Peterson. So.
Right. But I think Doug shares that. I don't think he wanted to come right out and say it.
No, but I agree.
We were talking about the fact that the 70s, as an oversimplification of rock music, was sort of an era of show. You have Bowie, you've got Kiss, and it's no longer the bands come on, play two songs, take a bow, and then the next act comes out, and that there's an element of performance to this. And it's interesting, of the bands you cover in your book, you've got Kiss, and that is most definitely a show. You have Aerosmith, and there's a performance there. You have Starz, who it seems like there was a performance there. And then you have Cheap Trick, who seemed to be the exception to that rule. Do you see them as that way?
I don't see them as an exception at all. I mean, I think that the thrust of the book is you know, focusing on these four bands who I think brought a theatricality to rock and roll. When rock and roll, you know, in the mid 70s, I mean, aside from people like Bowie, who was from the UK. But in America, I mean, you had Alice Cooper doing this kind of, you know, grisly stage show, but you didn't have a lot of bands really sort of playing into the performance aspect of rock and roll. You had Led Zeppelin, you had Deep Purple, you had the Allman Brothers, you had the Eagles, you had all these bands that were just up there playing music without any really any regard for, you know, bringing a theatricality or flamboyance to the production. So, I mean, I think it could be argued that Cheap Trick did that in spades. I mean, they had two gorgeous, you know, guys up front, the bass player and the singer, who looked like prototypical rock stars. But then you had this crazed guitarist with this upturned baseball cap and checkerboard outfits, being essentially a whirling dervish on stage. And you had in the back the drummer, Bunny Carlos, who, you know, wore Salvation Army clothes with a skinny tie and, you know, a cigarette drooping from his mouth, and he looked like a science teacher. So there was definitely a performance aspect to what they were doing, and there was certainly a humor there as well.
I think that's kind of what we were saying, and was exactly what you said, is that it seemed like it was a different kind of theatrical. Their brand of theater came out completely differently, completely unique, had that humor, had that just, you've got these two, I mean, I'm in love with Tom Peterson to this day, which will probably mean he'll never be on our show, but because he's probably afraid, but that, you know, Luke was just mentioning, you know, Robin had, you know, tongue in cheek, is introducing himself as like, hey, I'm the lead singer at the Rock and Roll of Fame inductions, you know, and it was just such a different thing they came out with.
Yeah. I mean, that's a great point. It's something that I also kind of stress whenever I talk about Cheap Trick to people. You know, Robin is the singer, but I don't think he's the front man of the band. I think, you know, Rick Nielsen is the guy who you can't take your eyes off of when they're performing. And I've seen the band probably 50, 51 times now. And, you know, he certainly, and to this day, he still is the main kind of performer on stage. So yeah, he's the front man.
So what was the impetus to put these four bands together and look at the role they played in pop music at that time?
Well, you know, I always wanted to write a book about 70s hard rock, because that was the music that I grew up with. And that was what initially drew me to rock and roll in the first place. I mean, I got into Kiss when I was probably 11 years old. I was a sci-fi, horror movie, comic book kid. So they really played into the visual aspect of my aesthetic. And the music actually came second with them. The image came first. And I always wanted to write a book about that era. And, you know, looking at Gene Simmons' solo album from 78, I realized that he had members of Cheap Trick, Starz, and Aerosmith playing on the record. And I always wanted to tell the story of 70s rock, but find an interesting way in. And I thought that was a really interesting, organic way in, figuring out how much these bands intersected in that era. And, you know, Cheap Trick opened for Kiss in 77, which basically made them nationally famous. Starz were managed by Kiss's management, and they toured extensively with Aerosmith in the 70s. And Aerosmith, you know, just had tentacles with all of these bands. So it seemed like a really kind of interesting way in to tell the 70s rock story from a different perspective.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's great. It's such a fun read. It's such a great book. And I will tell you that I always got a little nervous, though, when we got to the sections about Starz, because their path was so different. And I was always like, oh, no, I can't hear the hopes and dreams get crushed. I just can't.
Well, yeah, it's funny. I mean, one of the things I wanted to do in the book is, you know, not only tell the story of the successes, but in the case of Starz, they're kind of an avatar or a representative of a certain, you know, a certain kind of band from that era you know, bands like Montrose and Angel and Head East and all of these bands that had similar opportunities to these other bands, but never really succeeded. And I wanted to find out why. I mean, I grew up in the 70s in New York, listening to rock and roll on the radio, and I never heard Starz. I mean, they were on Capitol Records for four albums. They had Jack Douglas producing, who also produced Aerosmith and produced Cheap Trick. So they had a lot of the benefits of these bands, but they never got on the radio. And I didn't really discover them. I didn't discover their music until, you know, 16 years ago when they were re-released on CD. The records were re-released on CD. So, you know, they were a band that kind of passed me by. I mean, I knew of them. I knew the logo. I knew they were managed by Kiss's management, but I never really paid attention to them back in the 70s.
What was it about them that you think didn't catch? Because the music's good. They are all very pretty. There's a lot of Vaseline rubbed on the lens on all their band photos. And you compare them to the other three bands in the book. They have all the same elements that those three groups have. What was it that they were lacking?
Well, you know, as someone said in the book, I think with Chip Zenuff of the band Enough's Enough, there was a lot of product back then and not a lot of demand. I mean, there were so many bands like that during that era, and only so many got played on the radio. And for some reason, and I kind of explore that in the book a little bit, AOR radio, which was kind of the defining format of the era and of the eras going forward, the so-called classic rock radio stations, they never warmed up to Starz. It might have been that Capitol Records didn't really promote them enough to radio. Maybe the radio programmers didn't really care for their music. I mean, there's so many different factors that go into those kinds of decisions. But back then, that was what you needed to sell a lot of records. You needed radio airplay. You needed a hit single. They had a single in the top 33. They hit number 33 with a song called Cherry Baby. But that wasn't enough to push them over. In fact, you know, the following album, that was from their second record. The following album, they set out to write hit songs because that was the mandate that they were given by their manager and by Capitol Records. You must write songs in this vein. So their third record was a lot poppier than their first two, and still they couldn't get on the radio. So it was just a matter of, I think they were not a band for their time. I mean, a lot of their stuff sounds kind of similar to a lot of what the hair metal guys were doing, you know, 10 years later. So they may have been early, you know, for that party.
Yeah.
Hmm. And it was so great to read their story, as sad as it is, and like Heidi said, and the Cheap Trick story, because I feel like Kiss, you can find a Kiss biography, you know, sitting on the curb.
Gene writes a new one every year. Gene just keeps churning them out.
But to hear the Cheap Trick story was fascinating, yeah, because it seemed like, again, these are guys who all they did was just tour and write really good songs, and they didn't get caught up in anything else the same way that Kiss and Aerosmith did. There was no interpersonal issues that sort of made its way out to the public until somewhat recently, but in that era, it was the four of them against the world.
Yeah, it's interesting, a story about Cheap Trick, because, you know, they did have a little bit of a hiccup that was pretty, you know, that became pretty career defining in 1980 when Tom Peterson left the band. And, you know, they had a succession of bass players who looked like Tom Peterson, two of them, in fact. And, you know, they had an interesting career because, you know, Budokan, the live album, really kind of put them over. But it also, in a way, hindered them because they had already recorded Dream Police, and that sat on the shelf for 9 months, which really did a lot of damage within the band, because they were, you know, they loved the fact that Budokan was a success, but they have an album that's sitting around for 9 months, and, you know, frustration sets in. It's like Bunny Carlos, when I interviewed him, told me, you know, we had to sit around for this record and we were all ready to move on to the next one. So, you know, that caused a little distress within the band, and, you know, the cumulative effect was that Tom left the band in 1980, and the next record, which George Martin produced, All Shook Up, never really, never really took off for them. Had a song or two that garnered some interest, but then throughout the 80s, until Tom got back into the band, they kind of floundered for a bit.
What's cool in the book about that, that I found though, is the way, even in spite of all that, the way you captured the band's, like, their description of when Tom left and how it made them feel and what it did to the band. Like, it really, it's beautiful because it, like, shows that that love was there and that if they'd had a little more understanding at the time, it's just, it's very rare that you see that kind of love exuded from bandmates.
Yeah. In fact, you know, Bunny Carlos, who I interviewed extensively for the book, who had a very bitter breakup with the band, as has been well documented, you know, he said to me, it's like, back then he wishes they had taken time to, you know, sort of hit pause for a bit and maybe had some support around them. That you know, he even suggested counseling. Maybe the band should have gone into counseling to figure out their next move rather than just essentially kick Tom out of the band for whatever grievance they may have had with him. So, yeah, I mean, even now when, you know, there is this rancor amongst, you know, Bunny and the other three guys, he still is kind of wistful about that era.
What kind of cooperation did you get from the other bands? Obviously, Bunny was available and willing to talk with you. You talked a lot with the guys from Starz.
Yeah.
Kiss and Aerosmith, what was their reception to you?
Yeah, well, Aerosmith declined to participate for whatever reason. I mean, there are a number of books about them out there, including memoirs and lots of articles. So I wasn't really starving for information about them. As for Kiss, Paul Stanley spoke with me for the book. The other members, including Gene, declined to be interviewed for this book. But I had interviewed Gene around 11 years ago for Spin Magazine when I was there. And I was able to use a bit of that conversation for the book as well. And, you know, again, all of the guys in Kiss, all the four original members of Kiss, all have books as well. And there, like you said, have been many books written about Kiss. You know, many of them have been, you know, official authorized versions. So there's a lot of material out there as well. But, you know, for the book, I was really focused on the interactions and interconnections between these bands. So that's what I focused on in my interviews with Bunny, with Paul Stanley, with all the guys from Starz. So, yeah, so it worked out. And there are a few cases where I wish I had more representation, like, you know, Brad Whitford and Tom Hamilton from Aerosmith and Joey Kramer are not, you know, they're not quoted extensively in the book just because they didn't say much about the other band.
Was there anything that surprised you? You know, you going in, you know these bands pretty well as a rock fan and writer, you're pretty well versed in this stuff. Was there anything in exploring those interconnections that kind of hit you?
Yeah, two things. You know, the first, which I think is kind of a poignant sort of aspect of the book, you know, Richie Rano, one of the guitarists from Starz, many years after Starz kind of broke up, he was selling rock merchandise, and that was his thing, selling rock memorabilia. And he got a letter from the IRS saying that the band owed a substantial amount of money because of, you know, deductions that were no longer allowed. So he had to try to find, you know, the books, the accounting books from his days at O'Coin Management in order to sort of get left off the hook for this money. So he and Brendan Harkin, one of the other guitarists in Starz, actually found the material they needed, the documents they needed in a storage space that belonged to Bill O'Coin, who had forfeited that storage space because he wasn't paying for it. So they had locked it up and they were auctioning off the contents. So they bought the contents to the storage space, which also included some memorabilia. And, you know, they sorted out their paperwork with the IRS and ended up not having to pay. But they also had this gold mine of, you know, promotional items and gold records and tour books and dolls and all this other stuff. And Richie Rano made a livelihood out of selling the merchandise that he bought from this storage space. So, and he started the New York, New Jersey Kiss Expo. So he basically got into the Kiss business after having been managed by Kiss's manager. So that was one aspect that I thought was really interesting. Another one, and I really hadn't known much about. The other one was the fact that I learned that, you know, both Kiss and Cheap Trick kind of sent songs to each other. So Gene Simmons, you know, he's kind of I call him in the book like a notorious Budinsky, because he's always butting into people's business and telling them unsolicited advice. And he would send songs to Kiss's manager for Cheap Trick. He would send songs to Cheap Trick's manager for Cheap Trick to cover. You know, he wrote these songs, you know, outside of Kiss, probably not meant for Kiss. And he thought Cheap Trick would have hits with them, and they never recorded his stuff. But then also Cheap Trick sent Kiss a couple of songs. So Kiss never recorded them. So I thought that was really kind of fascinating how these bands who were they were pretty close for a while. They even wanted to trade songs occasionally.
I love that. And that story about, not to go back to the rock memorabilia, but the story of I grew up in Troy, Michigan. So I remember very well the Northfield Hilton and how that went down. And I don't want to spoil it, but that is one of the best stories and such a defining, like the brilliant, like kind of assholeness of Gene and Paul in that moment is amazing.
Well, this is one thing, you know, when I was researching the book, you know, YouTube is such a treasure trove of material, and you wouldn't really think, you know, what could YouTube offer in a case like this? But there were people at this convention in the early 90s, mm-hmm. I guess, was it the early 90s? You know, basically recording home movies of the convention, and you can see, you know, this craziness going on when Gene and Paul go to a convention to raid it, essentially, and yes. take back what they considered, you know, their costumes illegally, you know, that were illegally gotten by merchants and, you know, fans, right. and basically just tearing this stuff off the shelves and on display cases. And you can see it all on YouTube. And it's just, I was just amazed that this stuff is around.
It's amazing. And then they turn it into like the greatest, but it's also becomes like the greatest convention memorabilia event ever, because they're there and it becomes an appearance for them.
Yeah, they start doing a Q&A.
Yeah. It's great.
Not to underestimate their ability to.
I love it. It made me love, I just love it.
Have you heard from any of the bands about the book and what their reactions have been?
Yeah, I've heard from a number of the Starz members who like it. I mean, they're happy to get the attention again, and they think I was fair. You know, I was always afraid that, you know, I didn't want to make them sound like Sad Sacks. I mean, you know, they did have a little bit of success. You know, if you're on a major label for four albums, I mean, that's a success. Mm-hmm. And now there's a book out from a major publisher with your name on the cover and your photo. So, you know, I didn't want them to appear as kind of the miserable dark side of 70s rock. And I don't think they come off that way. But they were, for the most part, really happy with what I did. And, you know, they're happy for the renewed attention. I talk about them in every interview I do for the book. People always ask me about them. I heard back from Rick Nielsen, who received the book, and he was just getting into it. And his comment to me was, oh, you have a lot in here from Bunny Carlos.
Of course.
And like, yeah, because Bunny gave me a lot of time and Rick gave me not so much time, but he was pretty generous. I haven't heard from Paul Stanley yet. I actually wanted to contact him to see if he's gotten to read the book yet. But yeah, so that's been the reaction so far. you know, I'm actually eager to hear what all the members think of the book.
Oh, yeah.
Well, and it's great to hear that Starz was so happy with it, because it was something when I first heard about the book, you're looking at the cover going, Kiss, Know Them, Aerosmith, yes, Cheap Trick, yes. And then I see Starz and I was like, did I miss something? My music education, how did they not come up? And so it sent me to Spotify to kind of go hear what they were up to. And so it was a great chance to sort of, like you said, rediscover this band. And I'm assuming the interest must have really had a bit of a groundswell because people are talking about them so glowingly in your book.
Well, I hope so. I mean, it's interesting because all four of these bands before the pandemic struck were either going on tour or already out on tour. You know, Kiss were doing their final tour. They were in the midst of that. Aerosmith were in the midst of a Las Vegas residency. Right. Cheap Trick were always touring, and they were about to go out for the summer with Rod Stewart. And Starz and Angel were about to embark on a small club tour of the East Coast. And it's just, to me, the idea that these guys, especially the guys in Starz, who never really had too much success, are still going out there. I mean, they reunited a few years ago, and they have some original members, and they're still going out there playing. And I just, you know, for all four of these bands, they're all in their 70s or nearing 70 years old. And the fact that they're out there plugging away, I think, is really admirable.
It's great. I mean, I've seen Cheap Trick almost every year for like 20 years plus. Every year without fail. I can't keep up, so.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen them, I think, like I said, I think 51 times, and can't wait to see them again because they're always fun. And even with the new drummer, I mean, the new drummer's been in the band for 10 years or more now, Dax Nielsen, who is Rick's son. But they still sound great.
They do?
Yeah.
And here's something that just occurred to me as we're talking. All four bands had members who left, who came back, and basically, I think 201, I guess Aerosmith is the exception, does not have all of the original members in the group.
Well, Aerosmith actually does now, because when Joe Perry left and came back, but
But is Joey Kramer?
Joey Kramer is original. He's an original.
But is he
original
playing
drummer
with them now? There was that whole kerfuffle over him having
question.
To.
I know. Yeah, he was kind of in and out for a while. That's a good question. Yeah. I mean, who knows when they play again? When they start up again, we'll see who's playing the drums.
Yeah, that's true. We don't know who's playing with anyone.
Yeah. How many members need to be in a band for you to consider it the band?
That's a really interesting question that Aerosmith actually bring up in the book. So, you know, when Aerosmith and Kiss toured together for the first time, I mean, they played a couple of random shows in 74 together, but they toured in 2003. And it was a co-headline that Aerosmith actually ended up being the last band on, and Kiss were a support act in a way. But the only way Aerosmith would go out on tour with Kiss is if they had more than two original members. They needed three original members in the band. Or Joe Perry thought it wasn't Kiss. He said it wouldn't be Kiss with only Gene and Paul. So they drafted Peter Criss back into the band. He had been gone for a few years. Tommy Thayer, who was basically replacing Ace Frehley, was part of the band as well. So that's a good question. I mean, in the case of Kiss, I mean, I still love Kiss. I still see them at you know, right now it's just Gene and Paul from the original band, and I think it's still Kiss. In terms of, I think Starz is now out with three original members. Cheap Trick has three original members, yeah. And Aerosmith, you know, who knows what's going on with Joey Kramer,
four or five, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think that if you have two original members of a band, it's the band, you know, that's kind of my rock band math. I mean, you could also argue that some bands are defined by their front men and that's all they need, but I don't know. I think it's when you get into that zone. It's more like a solo guy with right. with a support, with a cover band behind him.
Agreed.
So. And I guess it's nerd baseball if I'm sitting there going, well, it's not the bassist who played on that record. Right. So it wasn't.
So you've spent, beyond the book, you've spent, had an incredible career in music and writing through Spin and everything else. What, or who I should say, is your favorite band of all time?
It's Cheap Trick. That's, you know, it's funny. Yeah, throughout my career, you know, I've written about a bunch of bands. I actually went on tour with, I don't know if you know The Darkness, that British band.
I love The Darkness. Yeah, so yes.
I went on tour with The Darkness when they were touring the Midwest for the first time. And, you know, I love them. And, I, you know, I'm a huge music fan, but Cheap Trick has always been the band that I followed throughout their career, even in the, you know, even in the fallow years in the early to mid 80s. I mean, I always bought, I always bought those records. I always enjoyed them. And they're one of those bands, and I had the discussion with a friend of mine. They're one of those bands that even their worst records, you want to find something to love in them, and you always can find something to love.
Doug's book, They Just Seem a Little Weird, How Kiss, Cheap Trick, Aerosmith, and Starz Remade Rock and Roll, is available at your local independent bookstore or wherever you get books.
You can follow us on all the various socials. You can check out our website at rockandrollgradschool.com for more grad school content. And please leave us a review on iTunes. We're tired of asking our family members to do so.
Today's show was produced by myself and Heidi Hedquist. Our reluctant executive producers are John Sove and Sandy Stone. Our willing producers are Rachel Allen and Randy Jeanette. Our intern is Zach Jackson. Our graphic designer is Samantha Mastonen. This one's for Philippe. Thank you, good night, and may all your favorite bands stay together.